Hello, welcome back. Next lecture on the topic of optics. In the last block of lectures, we discussed the effect of interference, and today's lecture is on the topic of diffraction of light. So let me quickly summarize what we had so far. In the beginning, we discussed the wave equation of light. We derived it from the Maxwell equations. We made the assumption light is an electromagnetic wave, a sine function, E naught times sinus kx plus omega t. We plugged that into our wave equation, second order differential equation in space and time, and we got two results out of it. First result, yes, the sinus wave indeed provides a proper solution. And second, we calculated from that the speed of light being C naught is 1 divided by epsilon naught mu naught. Last lecture, we discussed the effect of interference. We started with the Huygens principle, which basically states that each wavefront can be treated as individual point sources. Each point source releases a new spherical wave package, and after a certain amount of time, a new wavefront is formed as tangent to these individual wavelets. So the propagation of light can be constructed from the propagation of single wavefronts from point sources. Constructive and destructive superposition of waves, very important for the understanding. If we have two waves which are identical in the starting point, wavelength is given here. If we add both together, if we build the superposition of them, we get a similar looking wave, same starting point, same wavelength, but the amplitude is now larger. It's simply E1 plus E2, the absolute amplitudes are adding up. The other extreme case, here we have a phase shift of lambda half. The maxima and minima of both waves are falling on top of each other. That's a phase shift of lambda half. And if we add these two waves together, they perfectly cancel out. So the upper case is called constructive interference, and the lower case is called destructive interference. And that's a main principle for the understanding of these chapters now. Double slit is shown here. Incident light hits a double slit. In that example, we treat it as a monochromatic light, like coming from a laser. The helium neon laser has a wavelength of 633 nanometers. Here are the wavefronts. The distance between both slits is d. And what we get if we place a screen behind the double slit, we get such an intensity spectrum. We uploaded a video for you where you could really see that interference pattern directly on the board. So this is not science fiction or fancy mathematical trick here. This is really what happens. And please watch out for the video again. This is the direct proof that this works. It's a proof that light is indeed an electromagnetic wave. How can we calculate that? This is shown here. First, we made an approximation that this small difference in angle here can be neglected. It's kind of negligible. Keep in mind the distance here is below a millimeter, and the distance to the screen might be 1 meter. If you calculate that angle, it's tiny and negligible. The second step was we tried to calculate this path difference here. The scattering angle theta is here, and the same angle shows up here again. From that, we can calculate the path difference. Sinus theta of this angle is S divided by D, the path difference divided by the distance between both slits. From this view graph, we learned that constructive interference takes place if the path difference is in an integer number times wavelength. If we combine these two expressions, we get finally the positions of the maxima. Sinus theta max is n lambda over d. The minima here and here are right in between, or in terms of destructive interference, lambda half. Minima are located at sinus theta minimum, n plus 1/2 lambda over d. N is an integer number and goes from 0, 1, 2, and 3. Finally, in the last lecture, we discussed the interference from a thin film and the Michelson interferometer. I'm not going into detail here. Please take your time and look it up on the previous video. The chapter of today's lecture is the single slit. And this is indeed something else, something different. Chapter 2.4, diffraction. Already here, you realize that we are using a different name. For the double slit, we use the name interference, and for the single slit, we use the keyword diffraction. Diffraction at a single slit. We have, as before, incoming wave fronts. Their distance is lambda. Here in the beginning, we treat it again as monochromatic, which means same wavelength. The width of the slit should be A. I really want to make it distinct from the double slit. And again, we will get a kind of a pattern similar to the double slit. It looks similar, but there are indeed some distinct differences. I would like to define three points here on the slit. P1, P2 right in the middle, and P3. We have to calculate the path difference again. And here I would like to focus now on the path difference between P1 and P2. This is the section which I would really like to concentrate on. Here our scattering angle theta towards the first maximum or minimum, and that angle shows up here again. So, from our condition here for constructive and destructive interference, we know that the maxima appear at a path difference of m times lambda. M should be an integer number, and here I would use m indeed again to make it distinct from the double slit. The minima show up at a path difference of m plus 1/2 lambda. In that case, I would like to calculate the position of the first minimum. I want to calculate the path difference for the points P1 and P2, which means from the corner, from the edge of the single slit to the central position. For P1 and P2. That's the important step here. The distance between P1 and P2 is 1/2. The condition for destructive superposition of waves is 1/2. If we plug both together, we get the condition 1/2 sinus theta is 1/2. This is the location of the first minimum. If we extend that, we learn that the minima are located at sinus theta minimum is, now we bring the a to the other side, integer times lambda over a. And the maxima are located at sinus theta max. Now, this condition holds, or in simple words, they are located right in between at the half positions, m plus 1/2 lambda over a. M is again an integer. But it's different to the number n. This integer number runs from 1. So And now I hope you can see both the upper frame and the lower frame. Here we have the conditions for the double slit. The maxima are located at n lambda over d. For the single slit, this is exactly the other way around. The maxima are now located at m plus 1/2 lambda over a, and the minima are located at m lambda over a. So, double slit, single slit, the condition for the location of the maxima and minima has simply swapped around. I'm using also two different letters for the integer, n and m, and they are indeed also distinct. Here it runs from 0 and here from 1. Because if we would plug a 0 in here, we would get actually a minima at this location. And this is one of the first most obvious differences between the double and the single slit. So our maxima are now at, if we put a 1 in here, 3/2 lambda over a. And here, 5/2 lambda over a. Minima locations are lambda over a, and so on. So the positions of the maxima and minima have dramatically changed if we change our setup from a double slit to a single slit experiment. That's very important to note. At the first glance, you get a similar looking diffraction and interference pattern, but if you look in more detail, it's really different. Okay, I would like to stop here, and in the next chapter, I wanted to calculate this intensity pattern directly. In the following, I wanted to calculate the intensity function of the diffraction pattern behind a single slit. So this is our single slit again, from here to here. The total width of the slit is a, which means it runs from a half to minus a half. We get maxima and minima on the other side of that slit. And as you have seen before, the maxima appear at m plus 1/2 lambda over a, whereas the minima appear at m times lambda over a, where m is an integer running from 1, 2, 3, and so on. We did calculate that at the first glance by choosing three points, p1, p2, p3, and we defined a path difference between point 1 and the middle position, our point 2. Now, I wanted to calculate the entire intensity function. And what I'm doing here is, first step, I define a phase difference from the path difference, but an arbitrary one, running over certain angles. And then I integrate over the width of the slit from a half to minus a half. So, what's our phase difference in general? Phi is 2 pi over lambda, and the section here, as before, is a times sinus theta. So remember again, this section here can be calculated sinus of this angle theta here, which is exactly the same angle as our diffraction angle. And here, that length is in a direction. That's our phase difference. Actually, now we can define an arbitrary phase difference. Phase difference between two waves. This is actually the section here would be G is y times sinus theta, y on this axis. And the arbitrary general expression, or not arbitrary, but general expression for our phase shift is 2 pi over lambda times g, which is y times sinus theta. This is just the geometrical expression for a phase difference. Now let me explain again. What I'm doing here is Huygens law, Huygens principle. I'm placing an infinite number of point sources here on the slit, and between each point source, distance from the top to each point source, I have a slightly different phase shift. So each point source acts like a new source for spherical waves, and between each of these point sources to the upper corner of the slit, I get a phase difference. And that's this phase difference here. And it's a function of y, which means a function here in this direction. That's the principle which I'm going to apply. And to calculate the full function, I will then integrate from here to here. So we will sum or integrate over all point sources which are located at that slit. Which means from minus a half to a half. So the phase shift between each of these points is given here. We have two waves, the incoming wave. This is E naught times sinus kx minus omega t. And the outgoing or diffracted wave, which is E naught sinus kx minus omega t. Plus our phase difference, k times g. This geometrical distance difference between the two waveforms originating from two different point sources here. To make our life much easier, I would like to use complex numbers here, and you will see in a few minutes why that's a really appreciated trick. So remember, a complex number is defined in a complex plane, where we have the real and imaginary part. The imaginary part carries an I, the imaginary with the following identity, and we can convert any number set into R times e to the power of I phi. R would be the distance, and phi the angle here. And that can be also written as R times cosine phi plus I sinus phi. This is how we can convert complex number from the Euler expression to a sinus cosine expression. Let's apply that here to our waves, wave functions, and we will get the following. The diffracted wave is now E naught times exponential function of I kx minus omega t plus k dot g. K dot g is k times y times sinus theta. If we also have a closer look, you realize that this part of the expression here, it's already seen here, with the section up to here, the incoming and the diffracted waves are identical. The only difference between both is this phase shift. So we can simplify that by simply cutting that out. And this is nothing else than our incoming wave. And we are left with the exponential function here, ikg or iky times sinus theta. And now the expression is much more sorted. It's much better to read. This is now a diffracted wave, or the wave function originating from one of these point sources. And what we have to do in the next step, we have to sum or integrate over all these point sources located in the slit. Sum or integrate over all the diffracted electric fields. So the total is the integral from minus a half to a half over this expression, incoming E field times the exponent of I k y sinus theta by dy. So we integrate over the entire width of the slit. And let me just do that here. The result is, and now you will see why converting it into an exponential function is so helpful here. The solution of this integral is pretty straightforward. It's the incoming wave, that's a constant, it does not contain the parameter y, and the integral over this exponential function is iky sinus theta divided by i
k y sinus theta. And this is running from minus a half to a half.
So that's the beauty of this solution. Now I want to convert that back into our sinus expression. And what we get here is the total result is incoming times sinus pi a over lambda times sinus theta divided by pi a over lambda sinus theta. Our final observed visible pattern on the screen is actually not the electric field, it's the intensity. And the total intensity on the screen is actually the diffracted divided by the incoming. Let's normalize it to the incoming beam intensity. And this is E total diffracted divided by E incoming squared. Remember, we discussed the Poynting vector, and the intensity of light can be directly related to the square of the E function. And this will be our final result. The incoming term cancels out, and we get sinus squared pi a over lambda times sinus theta, and here pi a over lambda sinus theta. We can simplify that. That's basically already all you need. And if you have a computer, you can plug this function in, and you will get exactly the diffraction pattern as I had shown you before. So on the screen, we had, this is our central position, we had this intensity pattern here. The location of the first maximum was 3/2 lambda over a. Minimum was at lambda over a. And here the same, 3/2 lambda over a. And it keeps on like that, 3/2, 5/2, 7/2. And a central position directly in the middle of the beam. So, as said, we can actually define a phase shift just to simplify that expression a little bit further. Delta is k times our g from the expression above, or 2 pi over lambda times g. And if we substitute that back in, our total intensity is the incoming times, and that's now a simple expression, sinus delta half divided by delta half. And our total intensity normalized to the incoming intensity, so E total divided by E incoming again, total electric field divided by the incoming, squared is this expression squared. Sinus delta half divided by delta half. So that's the simplest possible form to express this diffraction pattern. And simple recommendation from my side, simply try it out, use that function, and see if you can get that diffraction pattern. Thank you very much for your attention.